Welcome everybody to the Bagri Foundation's Open Up series. I'm Chelsea Pettit, I'm head of arts for the foundation, and I'm thrilled to have Sehej Rahal join us today for what we hope will be a fascinating conversation about his work, but also what's important to him today. Now, as many of you know, if you've been watching these series, we launched them back in June because we've been living through an incredible moment in history, and we felt there's so much going on in the world, so much change culturally, socially, environmentally, that it felt fitting to go beyond just talking to artists about their work and their studio practice, but also to really dig deep to understand what drives their work and what drives them personally. Sehej's practice touches upon some of these major themes in the world, from archaeology and mythology to ideas of utopia. So just a quick bio for those who don't know his work. And I love how his bio starts with this line: Sehej Rahal is primarily a storyteller. His sculptures, performances, films, paintings, installations, and AI programs narrate an absurd counter-mythology that interrogates the narratives that shape our present day. Now, this myth world that he creates draws upon archaeological records, conspiracy, science fiction, folklore, and orchestrates scenarios where indeterminate beings cohabit the porous boundaries of history, myth, and memory. And you'll be able to see this when you look at his work quite well. He's participated in solo and group exhibitions internationally, as well as major biennials around the world. With that being said, after this discussion is posted, we invite viewers to put questions in the comments section on our socials where we can try and engage further with him. So let's get started. Thanks, Sehej, for joining me today.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
I didn't mention that you're based in Mumbai, but I believe you were born and raised there and still working there. Could you tell us a little bit about your studio practice, where it is, and how you've been coping with the lockdown over the past few months?
First of all, thanks for having me. The lockdown's been a bit strange. Like, you know, it's kind of Bombay is pretty badly hit, so I've pretty much been indoors, and like, you know, my dad's in Punjab, and like he'd gone there just before, and my partner's in Delhi. She's an artist herself, Pallavi. So I'm kind of here by myself, which is kind of funny.
Have you been using that alone time to make lots of work, or have you been sort of demotivated? How has it made you feel?
I started like working, I guess, like I'd say about 2 months back, but like the first 2 months was like just kind of going crazy about it, like, you know, but yeah, now kind of eased into it. Also I started basically, like, you know, treating this entire thing as, so I've always wanted to have, like, you know, 2 years of like, or 1 year of like no uninterrupted like studio time, and then it dawned on me that this is exactly what that is, right? So I just kind of rolled with that, and then I've also been doing a lot of tutorials, and yeah, like, you know, like art tutorials and like programming tutorials. So that's kept me going. I've been auditing lectures on the new center, which has like fantastic seminars, so that, and yeah, that's what it's been basically.
Right. So you've been learning. Have your deadlines been sort of extended or melted away? Have you had a lot of cancellations or rescheduled things?
I'm part of the upcoming like Guangzhou Biennial, which is being pushed to next year. There's a couple of other projects sort of just been extended, but yeah, also what's generally been the case with, like, you know, prior to the lockdown is like it's been very neck and neck, in the sense I've been kind of working towards deadlines, and all of a sudden there was this lack of deadlines, and then it kind of got crazy, like just making sense of the fact that, like, oh, okay, now it's a little like loose and you have to make your, but then I kind of know how to build structures for myself in that way as well, so it's working.
And what about space? Is your studio nearby? Have you been able to go?
It's actually walking distance. So there was a bit of a we were kind of like in a red zone. So I mean I got a bit freaked out. So I kind of moved everything here. You have my brushes in the back.
You've been working on some things in your private space in your home at the moment.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Right. Do you have anything there that you can show?
So I've kind of got myself this big sketchbook, and I just kind of started filling up pages. I can flip through it if you like.
I'd love to see some of the sketches. Yeah.
It's kind of massive. It's like really big. So I'm going to hide my head while I run pages.
Okay.
I try to manage this. So it's like basically like ink drawings that I was doing.
Wow.
And
amazing.
Yeah,
that's just ink on paper. Wow.
Yeah. Like just. And it kind of became like this, and then this one's kind of like architectural.
Wow.
Anyway, so it's kind of just keeps going.
Cool. And are these just process for you, or are you thinking of an outcome and a work whilst you're drawing?
So for like I mean I'm about, I guess, a few pages in, and about 10 pages in or something, I was thinking of treating the entire book as this manuscript or whatever, or something that would be found, and it's like a one off kind of book that these codex sort of books that like artists were creating, it's almost like this absurd kind of like book of characters and illustrations, these kind of architectural illustrations of this space that and then I started also building a narrative around it, but then let's see how it kind of turns out. It's also a way for me to just get it's really meditative, don't feel like going to sleep or whatever. Just pull this out and start doing.
I'll read a book, but you'll actually create one. Amazing. That kind of leads nicely to something you've said to me before, which was that you've come from a storyboarding background and that you think of your work as storytelling and an entire narrative. Could you talk a bit about that kind of influence on you?
That was mostly to kind of make some money. I did kind of inform what I do. So this was back in art school. I majored in painting, and in fact, I joined art school thinking, I'm gonna go join one of these animation studios or film studios and make storyboards for them. And the whole idea was to kind of, get a certain skill set and then start doing that. And I did do that for a bit. But then also I kind of got burnt out. Which is why I sort of stepped away from, I was still doing that, but as part of my art practice or whatever, I was working with found objects and trying to build these things out of a certain amount of randomness, I guess. That kind of led me to essentially my sculptural practice and
Maybe we can talk about some of those early sculptures. I will see if I can get some images up here to share. Here's an example of one of your walkers, and there's many of them, I believe, and they go back to 2013 and they're still ongoing. Can you tell us a bit about these?
The entire kind of practice is this sort of expanding mythology, making these that sort of grows with each piece. And one of the sort of themes of this mythology is this idea of wandering. So there are these characters that kind of come about even in the performances that are sort of occupying spaces of commute. Itinerant sort of beings that just appear. And that's where, like, even these walkers were sort of like, you know, co-travelers or co-wanderers that were kind of populating this narrative that I was creating. And the way that these beings are created are, so the one that you're looking at, this like red chicken-like thing,
is of a giraffe.
Okay. So someone told me like it's like an alien alien tandoori chicken. So this was actually at the Bhavdaji Lad Museum in Bombay. It's one of my favorite museums. And I was sort of part of the this exhibition called Asymmetrical Objects, where it was kind of like 150 years, if I'm not right. Not sure. Yeah, but like since the museum has been around, and or maybe longer, I'm not sure. it's basically the museum itself has this like fantastic history. It's like an ethnographic museum, you know, which was built to so it was like a satellite of the V&A, and it's next to like a botany garden and and also a zoo. Yeah, so and there's this anthropological museum, so like it's kind of like, you know, very seeped in that kind of colonial gaze. But then
that installation then also echoes the zoo in a way. You have this kind of animal-like form.
Yeah, that's like kind of come out of the zoo. So the funny thing here, I create these things with things literally that I find on site. And these beams that this structure, this form's kind of built on are actually from... so there's this like nursing ward for animals in the zoo that's kind of like been converted into like a storage area now, because like it's the zoo sort of like, you know, I mean, there aren't that many animals there anymore. And yeah, so like, you know, I've literally kind of got them out of there, and these kind of large kind of bamboo sticks, basically, you know, massive like it. And then built the structure out, and like, you know, it's on. The funny thing is like it takes this shape, but then it also kind of like when I create these things, it's almost like, okay, what stands next to what, and like, you know, how does the entire thing stand against gravity? So it's almost like the shapes that I pick up kind of define the or the objects that I pick up kind of define the form. Like, you know, it's almost like negotiating with these objects how they would like to take shape. So, and then the history of that place also, or like the very everyday kind of like also mundane history of that place kind of defines the narrative around what these objects sort of.
That seems to be the way that you do. So there's lots of these large scale sculptures you've done outdoors, in front of museums, and you always use the materials that are in and around the museum or the locale, I suppose, at least. To build these material, to build it. But what about the stuff you put on top? What is all of that kind of that covers these materials?
So there's expanding foam, there's plaster, concrete, mud sometimes, and yeah, paint. Like, you know, I mean, literally whatever I can get my hands on. A lot of it is construction material because it's like very easily available. Yeah, like, I mean...
Are you evoking a sort of... I suppose what I get from it is a bit of a... I think I use the word primordial substance, or almost like they're coming out of the earth, out of sort of mud and clay. Is there that echo for you of a kind of pre-existence or pre-human, I suppose, existence in the materials that you're using?
Yeah, like, you know, so the whole idea of even building something and then building a story and then calling it like a mythology is because I'm interested in the idea that, like, you know, you can kind of put something in the present that can echo something in the past, like, you know, I mean, or like kind of gets its veracity from something that happened in the past. So it's almost like, you know, this system that uses that which precedes it to verify itself in the present, you know. So and this is something that kind of, you know, you see even with the, you know, sort of nationalist project that, like, I mean, it, like, India's undertaking, but like across the world, where you know, the idea of a glorious great nation that's built in the past, like, you know, and I mean, essentially, this past is, like, inaccessible largely, right? Like, you know, especially as far as, like, archaeology is concerned. And this is something that comes up constantly in my conversations with archaeologists, is that they're essentially drawing a line between two points, you know? Like, well, I mean, they're drawing this line both in terms of, like, physically, but, like, even historically, like, you know, so... they would say, like, one example that an archaeologist gave me was, you know, they'll find, say, a piece of metal on, like, at one spot. And then they'll, say, about 100 meters down, they'll find a spot where there was this wall that was, that has a gap in it. So they can, like, kind of conjecture that this piece of metal was actually part of a weapon that was used to break the wall. But then that's not true. This is just like a causal kind of link, you know, that and that is pretty much how, like, a good amount of archaeology works, you know, especially when we go to, like, prehistory.
Especially if there's not much written about that time historically, if there isn't something to kind of marry it up with, there can only be conjecture, right? Based on what we know of humanity or what we know of existing or... communities who've survived and lived in a certain place, as far as we think and we know. Yeah, archaeology is all about kind of creating those stories, I suppose, based on what's known. But I suppose that ties really nicely into mythology and the influence of mythology on your work as well. And I will go back to share your work, Juggernaut, maybe is a good example of that kind of influence. So I will go, maybe should we start with the paintings? Here. If you could tell us a bit about Juggernaut, that'd be great.
Okay, so Juggernaut was my third solo show at Chatterjee and Lal. And it was last year, where it feels like, you know, like forever. the show was basically kind of revolving around three ideas. Like, it had paintings, it had sculptures, and there was this AI program that I created at the spot. Now, the paintings were sort of like, you know, like the images that you're seeing right now, except that they're all kind of like, you know, really the sizes of these paintings, like, vary quite a bit, like, you know, so there's, like, large ones which are almost like 6 feet, and then smaller ones which, you know, about this big, and the whole idea of creating these images was to sort of create this fragmented manuscript, you know, and I was kind of looking at a lot of a very particular kind of, like, illuminated manuscript that it's called a cosmography. And, like, the best example of this is the Ajaib al-Maktukat, which I'm not pronouncing right.
Yeah, I don't know how we pronounce that, but it is, I can show people, Al-Ajaib Makrak, the wonders of creation.
Yes, the wonders of creation. So... What's interesting about this manuscript is that it kind of, like, you know, sort of sets out to document you know, like, maps, you know, so, like, it and yeah, so it maps out, like, you know, kind of geography. It maps out you know, these territories that are owned by the Persian kingdom, and also it's got bits of astronomy and astrology, and so, you know, you've got, like, these zodiac kind of maps and star maps at the same time, and then you have oceans that are mapped out, and bits of mythology, so folklore, that's mapped in there as well, and then you have like, very kind of, like, you know, very mundane sort of like, you know, everyday sort of things that are mapped in there as well. So it's almost like this compendium of things that exist and things that are imagined. So, and I like the kind of like, you know, that all-encompassing, you know, everything included kind of vision of this book. So that's where the images were coming out of, like, except that here what's happening is like, the paintings are kind of like, because they're different sizes and, you know, you're only finding, you know, this manuscript, say, is like revealing itself in fragments that are like of different sizes. It's almost like this book that you can't really, like, no one really knows what the shape of it is. Like, you know, is it changing shape, or is it like, you know, or is it growing with each page, or you know, what the dimensions of this thing are, like, are kind of like, you know, murky and opaque. So it's almost this ruse that's being kind of generated. Like, that's kind of like where I was creating these paintings from. And that, so I wasn't sketching these out. Like, the whole idea of like making these images was also, I'll, you know, sit with the page and start drawing, and then that will kind of lead to like one form, and then I'll, you know, kind of build on top of it, like kind of end up with like a creature at the end.
It's a little bit like the notebook you're working on now. I can see that kind of connection, creating this almost catalog of ideas and thoughts and places and beings. But it's interesting because I believe this is the show I actually saw when I was in Mumbai.
Okay.
And they're very, at first they look almost scary, like horror, but actually the kind of longer I dwell on them, there's a humor almost, or maybe that's the absurdity that you reference a bit in your kind of intro as well. And I don't know if that's kind of your intention when you draw these, that there is that kind of fine balance between absurdity, but the wonders of creation, but also a little bit of horror. Is there a bit of that influence, the idea of kind of horror in your work?
Yeah, totally. Like, you know, I mean, I'm kind of, so just to give you an example, because we're in front of this image, I was like kind of cooking up stories around them as well. Like, you know, so here it was, like, if you look at his teeth or their teeth, I don't know, what is it, a he, she, what does it like?
Yeah.
They're kind of like, you know, dirty, is it like, you know, because it's just been eating a lot of like, you know, paan and not like brushing, or is it blood? Like, you know, what is it? The story around this image was like it's this like strange antelope boar kind of creature that like hypnotizes its predator to run away. Okay? So that's the story behind it. Yeah. And then there's a tiger that you kind of like saw as well. That one. So here it was like the stripes of the tiger actually cause the hypnosis. So it like kind of mesmerizes its prey into like, you know, kind of just being like suspended or whatever, and then like kind of pounces on it.
Amazing.
So there was all these stories that I was creating on one side, and then like, say we go to the next image. Okay, so the one with the peacock.
Mm-hmm.
So like, there was this story that had come up, like, you know, I mean, like, I think in 2018, where this high court judge in India, like, so the first two stories I made up, and here, like, you know, this is something that happened in the news, where this High Court judge basically, you know, put out this claim saying that the peacock is the purest animal, and that's why it's our national, well, purest bird, and it's our national bird because it doesn't have sex. And this guy's in the High Court, yeah? Like, so, and the peacock reproduces by, like, you know, kind of shedding tears. So, like, the peahen drinks the tears of the peacock, and
wow.
That's how I was like, okay, so yeah, you have this like blind, I don't know where that came from, but like the blind.
Eyes are on the plumage. And well, I think they're, yeah, amazing to look at and really wonderful. And you've got some sculptures and things as well. But I'd love to just lastly talk a bit more about this work from the Vancouver Biennale Continuous Voyage, which I guess for me kind of brought everything together. And you've talked a little bit about your all-encompassing Gesamtkunstwerk, as I've called it, to incorporate an entire, almost an entire world that you've created with objects, AI, sculptures, there's performance, there's archaeological sort of types of elements to it. And I just, yeah, I just wondered if you could talk a bit about how you brought all of that together.
Sure. So can we go to the first image in this series? This was as part of the Vancouver Biennial. And here, so I created this installation again with things that I found in Vancouver, like, you know, so a lot of skip diving and like, you know, it kind of whatever literally I could get my hands on, like, you know, in there's a lot of recycling areas and like a lot of the waste that kind of generated. So like, you know, certain cities would produce a certain kind of waste, or like also what was happening was like I was kind of encountering a certain kind of waste. When I was working in Liverpool, it was a lot of like industrial kind of like detritus, so like large kind of like, you know, these industrial heaters.
Yeah.
And what was happening in Vancouver was like I was finding a lot of you know, offcuts from like foam boards and wooden boards, and that's also because there's a lot of these maker labs that are kind of in Vancouver that like kind of make these prototype sort of like objects, and they use a lot of CNC routing to kind of cut these shapes, and that's kind of like also what the, I guess, the city was offering in a way, like, you know, like that's how I sort of think about it. Because like, you know, I just kind of literally pick these things up, so, and then see what shape they can take. Now this installation was in this place called the Sun Ba Center, and it's in Chinatown in Vancouver, right? And it's, again, it's the area that was first settled by immigrants from China, like, you know, when the city of Vancouver sort of like came about. It's this strange, like, well, not strange, but like it's a transitory kind of space, like, you know, sort of like a Chinatown that you would encounter even in the Chinatown in Liverpool, for the matter. It's like, you know, it's this sort of space which kind of like immigrants kind of like enter as they enter a city. So so it has that sense of transition in a way. What was happening here was like, so it's this, the Sanwa Center is basically a shopping center that is now kind of being converted into an art space. Mm-hmm. And that's also to kind of, you know, to an extent, like, sort of hold it. I mean, there's this like kind of massive sort of like, you know, real estate kind of, well, how do you kind of, what's the word to describe it? Well, basically you kind of take over, like, that's happening. And then, and that's kind of, because of that, like, Vancouver is losing sort of spaces of like, you know, cultural spaces, I would say. You know, to kind of like these hyper capitalist kind of like, you know, sort of very shiny buildings. And I mean, that's something you see everywhere, like happening in other places around the world as well.
But this space is sort of the opposite of that. It's something that has failed. It's a capitalist creation of a mall, if you will, right? A shopping center that's failed and then become an art space.
But like, I mean, this is kind of, so I think the Sanwa Center had come up quite, like, it's also a cultural center. It, like, the way that it was designed was also a cultural center. And it's sort of like an interesting kind of like imagination of like, you know, it's not this like hyper kind of capitalist kind of place where like, you know, but it has like, you know, it has like a very, how do you sort of, it has cultural spaces built inside it, like, you know, and the kind of, so the architecture kind of lends itself to being a cultural space rather than a space that you consume culture, like, or like consume any kind of like commodity, just being that. And that was like part of its inception, like when it began that way. And then because of the fact that, like, you know, like a lot of shops, like, closed down in the space, like artist collectives have like kind of like entered and like, you know, opened up studios here, opened up galleries. This space that I was exhibiting in was actually completely empty. Like, it was like a storage space. Like, it was a shop, I guess, at one point, and then like when I encountered it, it was like a storage space. So again, like, you know, kind of, you see the kind of floor having like these marks of like carpeting that's been ripped out. And so now what was, like, I built a narrative around this entire thing, like, you know, so this, okay. Idea that like these kind of like trans-dimensional creatures kind of like appeared in the middle of, you know, this abandoned shopping area in Chinatown, in Vancouver, you know, and then there's a story that's kind of like, I mean,
that I built around. Oh gosh, it kind of reminds me of Stranger Things all of a sudden. Now that you've said that, I'm like, oh yes, they do look like they come from another, like a ripple in time. In the underworld.
But then the story also kind of says that they could have arrived from the future as well. Okay, so like, you know, I mean, that's sort of left to... So again, you have these like strange kind of like objects that were created using the detritus of Vancouver that sort of are pretending to be, you know, these trans-dimensional kind of like artifacts. And then, like if you just keep going down, like, you know, where I invited dancers to treat these objects as props, essentially, like, you know, to kind of like incorporate them in this performance that we like kind of collectively choreographed, where they were sort of like, you know, using these objects as extensions of their own body in a way. And yeah, it was just a kind of like, you know, sort of really fun kind of reinterpretation of the sculptures themselves, which were, you know, they can become kind of static, like, you know, because they have this like heavy sculptural presence, but then they're really light because if they're all made out of foam, and so, you know, the performers were kind of like turning them into strange kind of artifacts of ritual, and it was really fun to kind of like, you know, sort of see them make these objects their own, like, in a way, like they almost kind of stopped being something that I had created, in a sense.
Also reminds me a little bit of when I think it was Issey Miyake was making like set design sculptures for performers on stage at the Judson Dance Center in New York, you know, in the sort of 60s and 70s, that sculptors and dancers creating things together that can be activated is such a nice way of activating sculpture. Yeah, that's great. Well, maybe you'll do some more of that. What is next for you? What's on the horizon?
So I've been working on these AI programs. One of them was like part of Juggernaut, and the AI program itself is called Juggernaut. So the whole idea with that one was to create this self-creating sculpture. So, you know, when you kind of like, when the program kind of runs, basically you see this like strange purple blob that's like wandering this desert landscape. And the landscape has like pieces of architecture that are just strewn about, like, you know, some pillars that are just like kind of lying there. And so this blob is kind of trained to pick up like these bits of architecture and attach it to him, like itself. Like, you know, you kind of see it like kind of building essentially a limb, right? And then it'll use these to like prop itself up, you know, almost like kind of push itself into like like across the landscape. Also,
AI, so it's doing this itself. You're not telling it what to do.
Yeah, so there's two versions of it. There's one where you can, like, you know, and you can download these on my site. There's one where you can play as the blob and like kind of create sculptures by yourself.
Yeah.
So that's the possessed version. And then there's a sentient version, which is like controlled by an AI. And that, so the AI program kind of basically drives this thing and like kind of picks up objects, creates these forms around itself. As it sort of grows in size, it sort of becomes this strange sculptural thing that uses its like limbs to traverse the landscape. The whole idea here was also to kind of think about you know, how does like what does it mean to have like what if one of these objects that I was creating essentially, because they kind of give this narrative shape, right? Like what if they could actively play a role in the way that this narrative is taking shape, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's what kind of drew me to AI, and like, I mean, the whole idea of non-human intelligences. So just you know, a lot of people kind of ask me about this, so like just to be clear, I'm using really like dumb AI. I'm not using machine learning or anything like that. So the AI sort of scripts that I use are like they work the way video game like characters are programmed. So like, you know, they work on finite state machines. Mm. So there's like, you know, a set of like behavior trees. So like, you know, if this, then this. Like, mm-hmm. they're very like deterministic sort of statements. Like, you know, so if you see an obstacle, then turn, or like, you know, kind of, you know, okay. Go over it depending on a certain set of parameters.
Like a type of predictive behavior.
Well, yeah, predictive in the sense it's deterministic. So it's like if mm-hmm. this, then this. Right? So now what happens is like you have a series of these, and essentially what happens based on these very deterministic kind of like machinic kind of like, you know, if then statements, at a certain point of complexity, you arrive at this blob that is, you know, kind of producing this, you know, motion and then picking these things up at random. And I think that's kind of like, cool to, or like strange to, like, you know, come from like complete sort of, you know, a deterministic, very sort of encoded set of like rules that is leading to essentially chaos. So like a lot of behavioral scientists kind of like have this idea of the fact that like our consciousness is essentially this and this is where it gets into like, you know, kind of like conspiracy, like a lot conspiracy, but like consciousness and like, you know, like slightly strange ideas around consciousness. So what happens is the conscious self is like kind of a series, like basically a complex phenomenon that's like arising from these very determined sort of like, you know, set of like, you know, if you you know, if you touch something that is hot, then you move your hand away to like, you know, very complex kind of existential questions about like, you know, or whatever, you know, like what are you going to be eating for dinner or whatever, or what is the meaning of life?
It sounds like you're going to be able to spend quite a lot of time coming up with a lot more AI pieces and digital pieces using Unity, I think you said you use.
Yeah.
So, I encourage people to go and check it out, see how it operates, see how it works, and see what else you come up with. But I'm conscious of time because I could talk about your work forever. Because there's so many different complex ideas behind it. But I've got it. I have to hit you now with some of our probing questions that I promised I would do. And I'd love to start with. The one, if you could bring one artist back from the past to interview or have dinner with or something, who would it be and why?
Well, I don't know who the artist is, but like there is an artist who made this stuff. The reason I don't know is because like no one really knows. Anyway, so what was going on was in the Chalcolithic period, in the Copper Age in India, there's these artifacts that were found. The person I want to bring back is like whoever made those artifacts. What was going on was, so this is in Pune, which is like about a little, it's another city that's close to Bombay. There's a site called Inamgaon, which is like about 90 kilometers away from Pune. It's a Chalcolithic site. And what's strange about this place was the way people were being buried over there. Okay, so there's two ways in which people were being buried. So there's this one burial practice where the bodies were sort of flanked like compasses, like so the head's facing north and the feet are facing south, and the legs would be chopped at the limbs. Okay, so there's this happening, and so this is one practice. So you've got like a lot of bodies that are lined like this with you know, sort of trinkets and things like that, like weapons or whatever, like kind of lined against, like, so whatever their wares were, sort of their affects were kept with them. And okay, so this is happening outdoors, and indoors they were finding these urns, and the urns themselves were like kind of massive, you know, so massive three-legged urns, four-legged urns that entire bodies were put, like, sort of interred and in the seated position. Now these urns are the art objects that I'm kind of like interested in, and like how they got there and who made them, because so like I found out that there's this similar practice that's happening in Korea.
Okay, where?
In South Korea.
Oh.
Yeah. Like, except that there's no trade, there's no sort of communication between these two sides. But they're kind of doing like a very similar practice, like where the bodies are interned inside pots, and the pots are also shaped the same way, and they're put into these mounds basically, so, and there's this massive excavation site that they have in very close to Gwangju in Korea. This is in Gwangju itself, I think.
Is this research going to feed into your piece at the Gwangju Biennial next year?
It is. I'm actually building an
AI program. I can't tell you anything.
Okay,
no worries. okay, I'll ask you another question then. Which, is there a book or a film or a piece of music or something that you would suggest everybody needs to read or listen to before they die?
Any form of art. I'd recommend like Borges's sort of Labyrinth, or anything by Borges actually. Like, you know, you just like pick one story up, they're usually very short, and it's sort of like a gateway drug to like the rest of his work, because like you won't put him down, and he's like a really fun reader to read right now. Writer to read right now, what am I saying?
Do you remember the first book that you read by him, or the first essay or short story?
I do. This was like Don Quixote by Pierre Menard is the first book, and I remember getting really upset by the person with the person who kind of recommended it. It was pretty young, and like I remember this was part of like a, like it was some like a literary criticism kind of course that I had taken up, it was Abhay Sardesai who was teaching the course, who's an art critic and like the editor of Art India. And I remember getting up and being like, no, wait, you need to explain what is going on here, because like the story is this, like, you know, this guy Pierre Menard is kind of like writing this book such that he becomes the author. So I'm like, you know, is this like, what is going on? Is he killing off Cervantes, or, you know, what exactly happened here? And Abhay Sardesai just very mysteriously like says, yes, that's exactly what is happening.
Wow.
I thought it was really fun.
Yeah, that's great. I'd love to ask you, if you could go back in time to your teens or 20s, would you live your life the same way, or would you make a different decision somewhere along the way?
I don't know if, like, you know, like making these like kind of time travel like wish fulfillment stories is a good idea, because you know, there's this one, in fact, like this is someone who takes after Borges, I guess, like Ted Chiang wrote this story called The Merchant and the Alchemist's Gate, and like a very good sort of example of that is also in this German show Dark. Like, you know, where they have like these like this time travel upon time travel, and everyone's just like kind of in this cycle where things don't really change, you know, as much as you'd want to go back.
Like, oh, even if you try.
Yeah, it's just better to leave the past in the past.
Okay, two more, and then we're done. What are you most afraid of?
What am I most afraid of? Today is kind of like a strange day. The 5th of August, it's a piece of history actually is going to be like is literally occurring or has happened today, because like the the ruling government has decided to build this Ayodhya temple, and it's begun today, like, you know, and it's this strange act of erasure that I feel like my country is sort of embarked on, has been like walking. And I feel like the one thing that like kind of scares me is like that we'll forget, you know, that amnesia, that process of forgetting that has begun will actually occur. Like, you know, I mean, like I go on social media and like you see people like kind of like saying that, you know, that we will remember and like we need to remember. And it's like kind of, but that's the scary bit, like, you know, that like, yeah, that this fiction will come true.
Cultural amnesia. I suppose artists, hopefully, and writers, creatives really forevermore will find ways to capture these histories. Yeah. Let's hope. Okay, and then the last question is the one we always end on, and it's, what would you save if your house was on fire?
What would I save if my house was on fire? I don't know. Like, so I've had to do like very minor kind of like, you know, resets and like kind of jump starts all over again, kind of like, you know, once or twice. So like, and it's not been like, you know, kind of crazy, but I think I'd be fine. Like, you know, I wouldn't like be, oh, I need to take my like phone or my laptop or whatever. But, like, more or less it'll be fine. Like, so I don't really have like a thing that I'd keep with me or whatever.
So you're happy just to let it burn so you can start over.
Yeah, burn it down. No, I mean, I obviously not, but like, you know, I'd be like, I couldn't really think of like a single thing to keep.
Yeah,
in that sense. But, yeah,
that's so interesting, because of course, you know, part of the reason that we ask that question is to think about, you know, you do all these things and all these material stuff that you create and make and draw, you know, ultimately, is that what's important? Or is it the ideas, or is it the ability to restart with nothing, you know? And I suppose also because you work with objects that you're finding in local places that you work anyway, there isn't necessarily such a focus on having to take a particular piece of something with you. Maybe, you know, maybe you've created a special paintbrush or something that you have to take with you that you've created from scratch. But no, it sounds like, you know, because of the way that you work, you're able to start from scratch no matter what, which is a great feeling, I think.
Yeah, no, also because I make these like huge things, I don't really have space to keep them. But no, that's happened quite a bit. Like, you know, where, like, I mean, I make these things and like even if they're small or whatever, and then they, like, so like a lot of the sculptures that I made were like in Kochi and like in Liverpool, like are kind of, you know, returned to the earth.
Makes sense. Yeah. Great. Well, thanks so much for joining, Sahej. It's been such
thank
a great
you,
conversation. I hope you've enjoyed it.
It was a pleasure.
And I look forward to seeing what's next for you. Keep us posted on all of that. And I invite everyone who's listened to this to leave some comments and questions below the film on social media channels, so that hopefully Sahej can touch base again, have a look, see if there's anything else anyone really wants to know, and we can endeavor to answer those questions as best we can. And yeah, keep a lookout for more of the videos for our Open Up series due to be released over the coming weeks. Thanks so much.
Thank you.